to our Maundy Thursday service. If you're like me, you have to look up what that word means every year. It's it comes from a Latin phrase meaning new commandment. That's what Jesus did on the night before he was crucified, after supper, and after he washed his disciples' feet. He told them to love like he loves. That was a new commandment. And so we're going to look at that tonight and worship our Lord for him and what he's done for us. So I invite you now to stand together as we begin our time of worship together. Let's hear God's call to worship, taken from Psalm 116. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all of his people. Just who we want you to be or who we often make you out to be, but you, Jesus. You tell us in your word and you showed us in your life here that you are our Savior, our Lord, the Holy One, our friend, our brother. You laid aside your crown to love us completely, to love us wonderfully. Forgive us, Lord, for being so quick to tune out your words because we've heard them so often. May we think more highly of you and love more like you because of our time together tonight. To that end, we pray together now the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying,
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we remain standing, let's read together this passage where Jesus tells us about the new commandment from John chapter 13. Let's read this responsibly. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given him all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments, and taking a towel, tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Propitiation for our sins is what Jesus is, and that word is a word that means to satisfy the wrath of God against sin. In other words, to complete and satisfy God's justice. And so on the cross, as someone aptly pointed out, God's justice and mercy kiss through Jesus. God provided it. It's not something we can do, and he gives it to us. So now we can come to him and confess our sins because we never earned his favor in the first place. So don't be paralyzed in whatever is on your heart and mind. Confess your sins and be cleansed. Let's do that together. I invite you to kneel if you're so inclined. And I'll read this call to confession. And then our corporate confession is a prayer, a responsive prayer. You read the bold points. Let's hear God's word. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. O my people, O my church, what have I done to you? Or in what have I offended you? Answer me. I led you forth from the land of Egypt and delivered you by the waters of baptism, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
I led you through the desert 40 years and fed you with manna. I brought you through tribulation and penance and gave you my body, the bread of heaven, but you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
I went before you in a pillar of cloud, and you have led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I scourged your enemies and brought you to a land of freedom, but you have scourged, mocked, and beaten me. I gave you the water of salvation from the rock, but you have given me gall and left me to thirst. And you have prepared a cross for your Savior.
Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, hear us now as we bring to you our silent and individual prayers of confession. Thank you for hearing us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you now to stand and be reassured of this gift of salvation. It's yours and it won't be snatched away ever. This is taken from Isaiah 53, some 500 years before this night that we are talking about. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. If you believe in the wounded one, and if you look to him and trust in him for the forgiveness of sins, the Bible teaches that your sins are forgiven. Past, present, and future, forever. Let's sing out of a heart of thanks this hymn before you.
Good to be with you all again tonight. My name is Ryan, one of the pastors here on staff on this Maundy Thursday evening, and I'm going to invite you, if you have a pew Bible, we gave you the wrong passage tonight that I'm going to be preaching on, or I got the wrong passage, one of two. But what I'd like to do is actually preach from a different text. So John chapter 19, verses 16 to 30, and your pew Bibles. It's just the section previous to what's printed there. But it's on page 1152 if you want to turn there. And as you're turning there, I just want to remind you that this day marks the last week of Jesus's life. This night here is he's captured in John 13, where Jesus eats his last meal with his disciples and washes their feet. But there was more happening that night than clean toes and the giving of bread and wine. That night, Jesus gave his disciples something else. That night, Jesus gave his disciples a new commandment, the commandment to love one another. Now, that wasn't a new commandment, strictly speaking, because even from the Old Testament, from Leviticus chapter 19, and all throughout different parts of the Old Testament, we're called to we're commanded to love. In fact, it was tied with the Shema in Jesus' own words throughout his ministry. But it was new in this way. The way they were to love now, as Jesus said, as I, Jesus, have loved you. As I have loved you, says Jesus. And I just want to ask tonight, what did that love look like? What did the love look like? And John 19 tells us here. And so if you are willing and able, I would invite you to stand as we take a look at how Jesus displays the climax of that love with which he loved us. Not abstractly, not in a way that's without detail and color, but rather with real scourging, with real blood, and even all the way up to death. And so tonight, let's take a look at this text that's before us, and I want to show us two features from it as we begin. Really just a resistance to that love and the persistence of that love with which he loves us. Let's read together John chapter 19, and I'm going to be reading verses 16 to 30. Hear now the reading of God's word. John writes, "So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. And there they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, 'Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews.' Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, 'Do not write, the King of the Jews, but rather, this man said, I am King of the Jews.' Pilate answered, 'What I have written, I have written.' And when the soldiers had crucified him, crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, 'Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be.' This was to fulfill the scripture which says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.' So the soldiers did these things, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, 'Woman, behold your son.' Then he said to the disciple, 'Behold your mother.' And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. And after this, Jesus, knowing that all was now fulfilled, said, to fulfill the scripture, 'I thirst.' A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. And when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you please be seated? Let me pray for us just momentarily. Father, we ask now that you would, by the Spirit, come and show us the amazing love with which we have been loved through Jesus now. No, Lord, would the meditations of our hearts, with the words of my mouth, would all of them be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. You know, I mentioned just two things I would like to show you briefly tonight. Really, just jumping right in, the resistance to this love that's on display. And then secondly, the persistence of that love that's on display. And this scene opens here in verses 19 and 22 with Jesus having been arrested. He's been tried, and now he's being executed. And I'll leave other sermons to get into the nitty-gritty of what crucifixion was all about. But suffice it to say that Romans were skilled executioners. Crucifixion was one of the most brutal and one of the most shameful ways to die, reserved for the worst of Rome's criminals. Those crucified died an awfully painful death through, not through blood loss, that's what most folks think, but rather through asphyxiation, through the slow, painful death of losing one's breath. And now this gradual process. It's through this way that the victims meet their end. And we notice here on the cross that we're told for these criminals that a placard has been placed over Jesus' head with his crimes. Here he was claiming to be king of the Jews. But I want you to notice specifically what happens. I want you to know that the religious leaders, they took umbrage with this claim, as if they didn't know what was coming underneath Pilate's sentencing. And so they come to Pilate and they say to him, this sign here that reads King of the Jews, we need for you to change this here, Pilate. Change it now to say, this man claimed to be King of the Jews. And of course, Pilate says what? What I've written, I've written. But I really do think that this shows us something. John is showing us something here that's deep within the chief priests and the religious leaders' hearts. And that is, even unto his death, they do not want Jesus to be king. They want to relativize his claim. They want to soften his authority. This man claimed it, but he really isn't king. That's the effect of what they want. And this is because they couldn't possibly stand for the claim to be true. Now, it doesn't take a moment's examination, but to see in our own hearts how we find ourselves very aligned with the Jews and the scribes and the religious leaders this day. Because it's in us too. And in fact, it is a sign, it is a symptom of not understanding the gospel just like the Jews and the Romans as well. I won't let them off the hook. And it is this, that we desperately want Jesus to be something else than our king. So we might say, not our king, but it would be nice to have Jesus as my consultant who helps me sort of achieve the goals that I have for my life. It'd be great to have Jesus along for the ride for that. Or we might say, not my king, but my matchmaker. If he can help me find Mr. or Mrs. Wright, or if he can help me find a better and more attractive spouse, one who got in line with what I want for myself. Or perhaps, not my king, but my genie. A little genie in the bottle, when I rub him, he'll come out and he'll help me when I'm in a pinch. But someone who makes an absolute claim on my life, no way. But Jesus comes along and he says, you're not fit to run your life. I made you. And I made you for me. And your life only works with me at the absolute center of your life. And following me is the only way to real capital L life. Not because it's the best of some possible options out there, but because it's the only option for which I've made you. And so what does this mean for us? If you put something else at the center of your life, and then use or have Jesus come alongside you, he's sort of flying standby in your life to help you get that thing, whether it be status, whether it be power, whether it be relationship or love interest, whether it be success or wealth or health, if you do that, you will always be a fearful, miserable, and anxious person. Why? Precisely because you're enslaved to that thing. And you might lose it. And you're going to fail it. And it will get its pound of flesh from you when you do, one way or the other. I'll put a very practical point on it for us tonight, for your life on this Monday, Thursday, and that is this, that resistance to King Jesus, to Jesus' kingship, always in the end, brings misery and enslavement, full stop. Full stop. And friends, I just want us to see tonight, where have you, like the Jews here, begun to re-narrate Jesus' life for him? This man said he's King of the Jews. You see, if you're like me, you so easily want that sign to read errand boy or spiritual masseuse or wish maker. I just want Jesus to make all my dreams come true. But here's the thing, the crucifixion shows us where that game ends up. It ends up with Jesus on the cross. And I just want to say, is that the end of the story? If we were left there with the end of the story, what hope would we have? But the John keeps narrating, and he keeps telling us that there's another finishing going on here, and that is this. I want us to see, secondly, the persistence of Jesus' love, just ever so briefly, in verses 28 to 30. You see, in a tit-for-tat world, what goes around comes around. That's the law of karma. You get what you deserve. And you might think that these who are aiming to see Jesus die, that they would get in return what they have dealt out. But notice what Jesus is doing. He's doing something extraordinary here. Verse 28 tells us that Jesus knew that it was all finished. The work has been completed. That here Jesus is about to die, and his last words are, in verse 30, that it is finished. And Jesus here isn't just merely saying that his life is about to end, though it is. But he is making a theological statement too. Because in Jesus' suffering, there is something going on that is finished. And that is the payment for sin. The debts of mankind are all being wiped clean. The balance is being cleared out. That's what this word, it is finished. It's an accounting term that you would have received on a bill when it was paid in full, stamped, as many commentators have pointed out, with this very word. So just to illustrate, I can remember a time when I had gone out to eat with my wife, and we had a great dinner. It was so good. We were running up the bill because we wanted to celebrate. And the bill came. And right there on the bill, $0. Somebody who had known us in the restaurant, I suppose, had come and paid our debts for us. It had been accomplished. It had been filled. It's that sort of thing that Jesus wants you to see that he is finishing here on the cross. That God's justice has been meted out upon him toward all our sin. And it means in turn that God's justice toward us, if we are in Jesus, has been fulfilled as well. So that now we have the mercy of God. And this is what he is doing. This is what he is doing for any, believe it or not, who begin by resisting his grace. The Bible tells us that salvation from beginning to end is a work of God's mercy. And therefore that means that he takes enemies, he takes rebels, those who don't want his mercy, and he overcomes that resistance. And this is the mark of his love. This is what it looks like. There are those who persist in their resistance, and they see that love, and their hearts are opened up by faith to embrace the work of Jesus for them. Does that mean that everyone who resists is saved? Of course not. There are those who will persist in that. But it is the work of Jesus that, when seen, opens the eyes to the amazing love that Jesus has, to the amazing love with which he has loved sinners. You see, so that any who look to him, who see on the cross what he thinks of sin, that is, he dies for it, and what he thinks of sinners, that he loved them to the end, that when they see that and they own him, his love comes home. And this, of course, not to stay, but to move right through us, and that's what he's talking about, because Jesus on this first Maundy Thursday is saying, now that you have seen how I have loved you, and this act of washing your feet that will carry me all the way to the cross just in a few short hours ahead, I want you to see that I have given my life for you, and I want you as my people to love one another like that. The great Francis Schaeffer, the apologist of the 20th century, commenting on this verses here, John 13, 35, and just a few chapters later in John 17, 21, he notes this. These are his words. The world, Schaeffer notes, is called to look upon us and see whether we have love across groups, across party lines. Do they observe that we say, I'm sorry? And do they observe a forgiving heart? Let me repeat, our love will not be perfect, but it will, and it must be substantial enough for the world to be able to observe. And if the world does not observe this among sure Christians, the world has a right to make the two awful judgments which these verses indicate, and here they are, that we are not Christians, and that Christ was not sent by the Father. That's what Schaeffer says that the world is able to speak about us. Maundy Thursday is intimately linked with Good Friday because it is the same Jesus at both. And in his dying for sinners, he substantiates the love that he speaks of. This is the character of the love with which we are to love one another as brothers and sisters, not abstractly, but by giving our lives away for our brothers and sisters. This is what the King does. This is what the King does for those who don't want the King. And it is to set them free to look like their King. It's a life marked by his love for other troublemakers and for other train wrecks, just like you and me. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we ask that you would take these things, that you would place them deep into our hearts, that we would look to the cross, that we would see our dying Savior there, to see the great love with which he has loved us, and that love, O Lord, might mark our lives now so that the world would see that we are your disciples and that you have been sent by the Father. We pray this all through Christ. Amen.
In your bulletin, you'll see that we have before us Decalogue Litany, the Ten Commandment Litany. And what we're going to do is sing what is in bold, and then there'll be a moment where I'll read the Ten Commandments. One of the purposes of the Ten Commandments, there's a few, but one of the main purposes of the Ten Commandments is to be a mirror that is put up in front of us. Since we read these, we see like we don't keep these. We can't keep these, no matter how hard we strive. And so that's something to consider as you read this, and then as we're interlacing the song about what it costs Jesus to do this for us, is powerful because Jesus kept all these for you and me because of his wonderful love for us. So let's sing this together and consider God's word in the context of this song. Then God spoke these words, saying, "You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy."
Thank you.
your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet. Together and read responsibly in preparation to take the Lord's Supper, the Great Thanksgiving on page 13. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
Indeed,
right to do so. On this night, Christ, the Lamb of God, gave himself into the hands of those who would slay him. On this night, Christ gathered with the disciples in the upper room. On this night, Christ took a towel and washed his disciples' feet. On this night, he gave us an example that we might love each other as he loved us. On this night, Jesus Christ gave us the holy feast, that we who eat his bread and drink this cup may participate in his life, death, and resurrection. In the last day, may reign with him in heaven. On this night, we come in repentance and faith to fellowship with our blessed Redeemer, Jesus Christ. It is then our joyful duty that we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks unto you, O Holy Spirit, Father Almighty, everlasting God. And we praise you for Jesus Christ, our Lord, who in this dark world has blessed us with light and life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. We come to our Lord's table. I love that last one of those last lines of the song we just sang. They called him our dearest friend. Our dearest friend prepared this table for you and me. In fact, that night when he, after he washed the disciples' feet, before he was betrayed, he told his disciples, John 16:33, in this world you're going to have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. And this is food that he prepared for us. This is a practice he wants us to keep in order for us to remember him, who is our life, that he really is our dearest friend. We get wooed in other directions, but it's him. And he's our Lord, our Savior. As Ryan said, the only option. and a great option, a loving option. And he prepared this meal for us, so we take it. It's food for our souls. It's food that we can take heart and face and go out and love like we've been loved. And he loved unconditionally, and that's what we're called to do. We can only do it through the Holy Spirit's work in us, growing us to be more like Jesus. And this is part of that formation in all of us. So this table is for all of you who have Jesus is the only option. You're members of an evangelical church in good standing. This table's for you. If that doesn't define you and you're here just out of curiosity or you're wanting to hear more about Jesus, we're so glad you're here. Please talk to us. But this meal is for his people, and it's to give them heart. First, you got to have the giver of the heart first. So find Jesus first. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you love us. We thank you that you thought of us even when you had so much on your mind that night, about to be betrayed by one of your closest friends. You're about to bear the sin of the world. We can't even fathom it, Lord. And in the midst of that, you're thinking of others. You're thinking of us even. So thank you. Help us to remember you, what you've done, who you are, and what we have in you as we partake tonight. In Christ's name, amen. Scriptures tell us on the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of sins for many. Drink of it, all of you. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take these in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, and drink remembering that Christ's blood has been shed for you. It's our practice to come forward for communion. If you're not able, please just tell one of the ushers, and we will gladly come and serve you. Remind you, all the bread's gluten-free, and there's wine in the cups, except for the outer rim is grape juice. And also, if you're not partaking, we still love you to come forward and receive a blessing from one of the elders. So let's keep enjoy God's feast together now. Let's keep the feast.
Thank you.
pray together with me this corporate prayer of blessing, you'll see there's a part for you there, which means you get to pray with your eyes open. And so will you join me as we pray together? We bless you, God our Father, that on this night your Son Jesus humbled himself to wash his disciples' feet and modeled the servant way of your kingdom for our life. We bless you, Lord Christ, that on this night, a table of the finest wheat and abundant wine, that we may taste your goodness all the days of our life. We bless you, Spirit of God, that on this night you help us to pray, not ours, but your will be done in all the public and private places of our life. We bless you, Triune God, that on this night you lead us from the upper room to Calvary and from death to resurrected life. Amen. Now I would invite you to lift up your heads, lift up your hearts, and receive once again our Lord's generous word and gracious word over you as you depart. And now may this God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May this God, Father, Son, and Spirit turn his face to you and give you peace. Amen. And now let us go and serve the world and our city as those who love our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, thanks be to God. Amen. Please go in peace. Good night.